The bill. This is the Rhode Island retirement bill. It's some 200 pages, and it is a really good read. If you want to go to sleep, this is what you want to have. I used to think the budget was dry. This is really dry. But what it does, having been through it a couple times, the major components of it are, it will create a defined benefit in a defined contribution plan, which means there is going to be a defined benefit, which is what they have right now, all the employees, and they're going to have a 401k that they're going to be able to manage themselves, and it'll be split. You're going to pay a portion of it. They're going to be paying a portion in also. Their contribution is going to be 8.75% across the board.
And who is the they?
All state employees, including teachers. Mm-hmm. Your teachers are currently paying 9.5%. This this reflects a 0.75% reduction to what they'll be paying in. They're in their own pension systems, and a lot of myself and my colleagues are looking at that, trying to bring a little more equity to bear. Considering I'm not a lawyer, I really don't have to worry about any of the issues with the judges. They will contribute 3.75% of the pay towards a pension themselves. The retirement age, this is another, those are two big points. Retirement age is going to move up to what it is right now at Social Security, 67 years. If you are 52 years old and are vested, you can retire prior to 52 under the current system. Another huge bone of contention will be the cost of living adjustment. It will be put into stasis until the entire pension system is fully funded at 80%. We're going to re-amortize. This is also another very touchy point. We're going to re-amortize the pension system for another 25 years. This has a great thing for the taxpayers on the front end. It's really bad for the taxpayers on the back end. I don't know if anyone saw the Providence Journal this weekend. I thought it did a fairly good job explaining how the money worked. And the independent municipal plans, of which Tiverton has one, which is the police system. The municipalities will be required to handle those on their own and to come up with a program by April 2012 that they'll submit to a solvency board. That solvency board will then review it with the city or town and determine whether that's going to work or not. They will also pay for half of a, another word escapes me, to have an actuary done. The state will pay for half. Have an actual actuary done. That's the main crux of the bill. From what I understand, Tiverton's, all the other unions and all the other contracts are under MERS or the state teachers retirement system. The police department is the only one which is outside of that, and I believe they are somewhere 45-48% funded. That is critical in the state system, as defined by this legislation.
So your concern with the resolve is you didn't want things real specific that may have to be...
No, my concern with your resolve is you should make it very specific.
Okay.
If you want to have things done, if you want to have re-amortization done, if you want to have the COLAs put on a stay, if you want to have things done, you should be very specific. You are telling your legislators, you have two senators and two reps, you're not telling us what you would like us to vote on. This is your one shot.
So it's overly broad.
Yours is overly broad. I get them all the time.
Yep. But I think as a committee, rather than have a lengthy discussion on those particular points, we as individual constituents can call and offer our opinion. I think as a committee, the bottom line is really our common ground, that we all agree that the reform has to be enacted, because not to do so is going to bankrupt us.
I would suggest, if I could be so bold, that you pick out a couple points that are strategic in the bill. The COLA. Everyone I'm hearing from is upset if you are going to be receiving one or you're going to be receiving one. Everyone else I've heard from wants it suspended. Right off the bat, if they suspend the COLA, our pension system runs from 48% funded to 62% funded in one fell swoop. That's a huge plus. I mean, that's something the state really can't avoid. That might be something you want to include in there. I don't know your feelings on re-amortization. You might want to include that. It's up to you as a committee. But I would pick some specific points that are going to be controversial that if you as a committee can come up to consensus with, you might want to include that to let your General Assembly members know.
Well, so I wonder if you look like you kind of had a summary there that you were reading from.
Mm-hmm.
If
I'd be more than glad to provide it.
Yeah, is to get that and maybe continue this to a future meeting so that we have a chance to look at that and see if there are any specifics that I don't know. Or your general feeling, Carol, still is you'd like to leave it just more general.
I think it's going to take a lot of our time, both outside of this meeting, to read through the bill and to try to get some grasp of the impact of leaving in things and taking out things, for us to reach that agreement. And I'm not sure that that's within my ability. For instance, increasing the retirement age to Social Security 67, that certainly seemed like a good idea to me when I read it. I just read in the paper, though, that there's a question about whether that will not ultimately increase costs to school districts, because they will be carrying top-level teachers for five or more additional years.
And it'll decrease the amount of number of new teachers coming into the system,
right,
because
so
you have the older
I
teachers holding the spots.
Take a position saying, yes, we should increase the mandatory retirement age or minimum retirement age to 67, when in fact that might end up backfiring and costing us more money, and I don't know at that point.
If it takes us so long to do that, we miss the window.
You also have a group of teachers who are in part what's called AB category. I mean, I'm one, Mr. Fizette, and a number of teachers across the state and administrators are. We're not part B, which is the work to 62. So if you're going to be telling everybody that it's going to be 67, we would have to run almost actuarials to say, is it everyone who's 67? I mean, we would need to see the charts that to see, who can go, when can go, when they can go, and then apply it to our own model in Tiverton to say, well, yeah, this is going to just off the top of my head, it seems it's going to add additional costs. If people have to work just even five more years at top step, and you're asking people, the teachers would be working 45 years, many of them will be at your top step after the 10th year they work. So for 30 plus years, you're going to be carrying employees at your top step in some cases. So, I mean, there are costs that, I mean, yeah, we could look at those things, but we would need more data to make that.
Yeah, Mr. Bugatti, this came from RIASC. Was this their recommendation?
That basically what they do is they us own committee which represents all the school districts which are part of that organization. They usually take a position on things like this, and everyone understands that it's extremely important. You cannot drag your feet anymore. So the only thing this resolved was, better get your act together and come up with some solution, as opposed to suggesting any particular element.
I think maybe the committee could have, and I know, Representative Edwards would like specificity, but maybe we could pass this resolution to say, we want, Tiverton School Committee favors reform, and then as more information gets called out or is brought forward, they can take maybe more of a specific, take another resolution or more specificity saying re-amortization. Yeah, we've looked at it, we favor that, we favor this, we don't favor that. As opposed to right now, and I think that the intent was just simply to send, to tell our state reps and senators that something needs to be done, because as we talked about with Representative Edwards and Senator Felag, if the current program isn't changed, we're already in the red. If the current system, if the retirement numbers hold that they gave us a couple months ago, it will cost us a little over a million, and we only have 800 and something thousand if we went to the cap, the 4% cap. So something needs to be done, because otherwise we start in the red. I mean, so.
If this goes through though, Phil, you're actually, you have a savings next year on this.
Right, in other words, this would create,
from
the million, yes, we would no longer be in the red. We would then, be in the black.
Well, I certainly definitely agree with that. So for purposes of the motion, and then we can continue discussing, but I'll make a motion that we pass the resolution after.
Second the motion.
Just let me say that when you pick up the New York Times, you see the little state with a big mess, you know that we have to do something. We all know that. Considering the employees, people working, people that are retired, everybody else, it's very complicated.
No, I was just going to say that we cannot forget that Tiverton is still part of Rhode Island, so if looking at our, the impact of this reform on our particular town, we cannot just look from this perspective that this is going to cost us more or less, because at the end everything has to balance. So it means we will be hit somewhere else, because there's no coffer full of money. So at some point we are going to, it might cost us more in annual budgets as opposed to costing us $1 million up front. So all of this has to balance. So I don't know if this type of careful analysis, what particular item in this whole bill is going to do for us. It's, everyone's trying to rip it apart and say, let's replace this with that. I can imagine what you guys are going through. But every one of these elements, if removed, makes everything somewhat void, because it does not address the whole problem.
Yeah.
Is this correct?
Okay. Concerning four of you are my constituents, feel free to contact me anytime. It's always good to leave on a good note. I have in my hand a check for a grant that was requested by the middle school. It was a continuation grant. And the two people who really pushed me on this issue are both present this evening. So I'd like to have both of them come on up and get the check.
Come get your money.
Go get your cash.
Sorry, I'd hug you, but there's a room full of people.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. We so appreciate it. Thank you very much.
And it's made out to the school department and the Tiverton Middle School, so you have a little bit of control over it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Alves is asking for permission for the band to go down to Williamsburg, Virginia at the end of April for 3 days to perform in competitions down there. Mike, you want to speak? Does that cover it?
That's it. It's pretty cut and dry. Yes.
Man, a few words.
Yeah, that's a rarity. That
sometimes.
Mike, it's very.
Does anyone have
reserved.
Any questions?
Make a motion.
I'll second the motion. I would just like to add what a wonderful experience it is for our music students to have the opportunity to participate in these adjudicated performances. They do have a lot of fun while they're doing it, but they work very hard preparing for these trips and very hard while they're performing at the trips. And I know they take away a lot.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Do you want to do findings? I'd just like to move up, we have another staff member, 5E, please.
Five what?
E.
5E is the prevention consultative and prevention coalition.
Yes, she's in there.
All those in favor? Mrs. Elwa, could you just come and speak a little bit about all the wonderful work you've been doing in the prevention coalition?
I didn't know I was gonna have to come up, but thank you. I think probably the highlight right now that we're focusing on is prescription drug abuse prevention. Just a couple of highlights. We started right before the school year started, Detective Mike McGill from the Tiverton Police Department came in and was a guest speaker for the pre-season athletic meeting that they hosted at the high school, and talked to the students and the parents about issues regarding medication abuse and over-the-counter drug abuse. And so we're following that up for the rest of the school year within the community mostly, and providing some education to the students. But the next piece of that is Saturday, I think it's the 29th, at the Tiverton Police Station from 10 to 2, they're doing a prescription drug take-back day. And that's in conjunction with the DEA. They are actually taking the drugs to incinerate them. So anybody with unused, unwanted, or expired prescription drugs can turn them in safely and know that they'll be disposed of appropriately. And so we're going to continue sort of on that theme, dealing with prescription drug medication abuse, the risks, the dangers, that kind of thing, and also the safe disposal.
We also, I think this is appropriate. If you notice, Rebecca resigned as community service coordinator, and she's doing so because she's going to be, we asked for permission from the committee several months ago for, do you want to just explain that to Grant?
If I may,
yeah,
sure.
If you could.
I didn't know I was going to get to share this great news. In August, the very end of August, the Tiverton Prevention Coalition was notified that we have been awarded a federal grant in the amount of $125,000 a year for the duration of 5 years. And that is primarily to focus on community-based prevention. We had to choose three sort of issues or substances to address. Underage drinking was one of the requirements. And so we also chose marijuana abuse and prescription drugs. So basically what we will be doing is working on changing the culture of the community that makes substance abuse and underage drinking accepted or allows it to happen. We're going to be working on parent education, some work with students, but it's really not addressing individual student behavior. It's really addressing the attitude within the community. So we'll be working with law enforcement. Hopefully, if we get to the point where we find that policy or ordinances in Tiverton could be strengthened to support prevention, we'll be doing that. But it also, in my leaving my job at the school and working, doing the prevention full time, it really allows me to represent Tiverton at the state and federal level. I'll be going to Washington in December for a national meeting where, you know, Tiverton is representative of Rhode Island, and Rhode Island is representative of the United States, and the fact that we're all dealing with these issues, and sometimes we work on prevention issues in a silo. Much more useful and productive to work in at a larger scale and a larger level, and then bring it back to our individual communities. So my resigning from my position at the school in order to do this full time will really allow us to be a player on a much bigger stage.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'd just like to mention one of the reasons we got it was because we were shovel ready, because we had our prevention coalition.
Thank you. I think that's a really key and important piece of it. We did not receive the grant because Tiverton has a higher need or is at higher risk than other communities. Tiverton received the grant because of the partnerships that had been established between the coalition and the police department, the coalition and the school department, and other entities, so that they looked at what our proposal was and they looked at our capacity to actually carry it out, and felt that those two things were in alignment. So it's a very exciting thing to be able to go out knowing that someone with, you know, with money to fund us has the confidence that we can carry out and do what we say we're going to do, and not be coming from the position of a need-based where, you know, it's going to be a struggle to make the impact. The belief is that we can make an impact in an already positive place where good things are happening. We can bring it up to the next level.
And the other thing I'd like to point out is there was no money match because we don't have any. It was in-kind time. We give our time, so that was our match, all the people on the committee and the back, and so that was really good. Mm-hmm. And she's been trying for years, and we give up. They threw us out the front door. We went around the back again, and we just keep trying, and this is a wonderful result, and it's going to be wonderful for the whole community. Thank you.
Before Rebecca goes, I want to thank her for the years that she worked, not only with the coalition, but she'll continue her work, but on our community service program. It's really through her efforts that we have a state-recognized, you know, community service graduation requirement, and it goes to all the work that Rebecca has done over the years, creating partnerships in just not Tiverton, but in many of our surrounding communities. So thank you, and again, we'll continue working with you, and I also think sometimes it gets overlooked because Sally's always talking about it, but she's really the driving force, one of them, on the Tiverton Coalition, so I recognize her for all the work she does because it goes really under the radar in many cases, and it's good that we can talk about it in such a classic way tonight. So
well, I always put these things on here because I want the whole committee to know what is happening because I'm only one person and we all together here. So thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. The policies are easy.
Okay.
I think.
Policy development.
Okay, under our new policy 220, in the past we used to put the subcommittees used to look at the policy, put it forward, and then be voted on. Well, again, the adjustments a couple months ago now requires the subcommittee to submit it to the whole committee. We post it. We allow anyone who would like to comment on it at this meeting. Now's the time where committee members have questions. Now's the time to ask about what are the various policies, and then at our next meeting we'll vote to approve them, assuming no changes are made, or if they are, we approve the
amendment. Right.
Changes.
So if anyone reads these and has further questions at our next meeting, they can present.
Yeah, they can still come, sure. That doesn't preclude, people.
And these
from
are
speaking.
Available on our
yes.
website.
Yep.
You want to just read the
yeah, the
policies?
Yes, the policies are policy number policy number 1200, policy on homeless students and families. Policy number 355, guidelines for acquisition and updating of technology. Policy number 1171, acceptable use of the internet. Policy number 1173, employees acceptable use of the internet. And policy number 1174, computer security.
And thank you for all that hard work on this policy committee.
And I want to also thank Mr. Natariani, who served as a consultant to us on these issues. Can we just do this real quick, the website, and then take everything on? The website, I'm sorry, you got
to
take a vote.
I make a motion to move item 5C, update on school department's website, up on our agenda.
Second. All those in favor?
Okay. Up on the main screen, as we told the committee that when we came back, we would have for you the final, what it will look like. As you can see up here, when this goes live, this will be the main page. With Al, do you want to get up there with your little drag down thing so they can see, please? I don't have the.
Yeah, nice, huh?
As we talked about, we wanted the pictures of the students to highlight, our website. And as you can see, we have just four main drawdown screens or links. And they're in gold,
nice.
As best we could get it to match our school colors, which was harder than we thought. But you can see all the different, and again,
this is the main page, and then you can get into, Al, can you just show how we could get to the schools? I think you already did it. And then just bang, click on that. And then they have their information listed there on the right for upcoming events and things of that nature. And we have the little animation with the bat flying around.
And
the
when ladder. Will we go live with this?
Hal?
Content has been posted to the website, or it's continually being posted as new information. Comes available for current events. I expect to roll out the login names and passwords to the staff throughout this week and next week. So it could be as early as Friday, as late as probably Wednesday next week, that it will be live.
That the public will
yes.
see this when
the
they...
Yes, and we're already live with our iParent. Mm-hmm. So parents at the high school and the middle school can access
there,
that.
I think we talked about this. There's going to be a central calendar now, so
yes.
that we have no more, oh, I didn't know your event.
No, when we make the change, okay. Yeah, there'll be a district calendar. If you on the main page, yeah. right, Al, there was a main calendar.
Each site, is it the district site, yeah. each building site has a calendar, which will have a calendar of events. And then you'll notice in the middle of the screen where it says district announcements, yeah. that whole window pane there is announcements for the district as well as the building. So what will happen is, for example, if the school department or the district has an announcement, such as the welcome message, that will appear on the district page, and it will cascade to the building pages. And then each building will also have the ability to create an announcement. So as a
But parent, we'll have like a district calendar, because one of the things that the PTOs and the parent groups often find is you schedule an event and you don't realize that someone else had an event.
Right. Well, I had a meeting previous to this with the PTO.
But this
parents.
Will allow us
Right.
To
well,
do that, though.
As long as we get the data.
Right. As long as the date's in.
Yeah, the date's in, we can put it onto a
calendar,
yes.
And go, oh,
right, you're not in conflict with something, yes. That's our goal.
And
do we have some link with directions to the schools? And maybe some image, especially high school, because a lot of people travel for the games.
Yeah.
So when you go and say, where do I go? Maybe some link to Google Maps, like.
On the bottom right, there's the address, and I forget exactly what the terminology is, but it brings you to Google Maps. So if you want to go to the
right, even for our college fair this week, we
yeah.
have
yeah.
visitors coming
yeah,
from
especially high school.
Say locate
far
school.
Away.
It has the phone number and it has locate school. When you click on locate school, it will come up driving directions.
It might also be good to have an image of a building.
Well, we talked about that because of the program we purchased. On the main page on the left, it doesn't allow for that, mm-hmm. like we do now. We could have we could try to get pictures on the different individual sites of what the school looks like.
Yeah.
We can look into that.
You can look locate,
could make a picture of the kids in front of the school, something so
mm-hmm.
someone knows
mm-hmm.
approximately what to look for.
Yeah, we can work on that.
And then you can look here and get the directions.
That's why we wanted to bring it back for input. I'll work with Al on that, see what we can do. If you notice the person playing the big horn there, I think you might know
him. I was going to say, I recognize him.
You might know the guy on the right.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Is that okay now?
As long as I'm not going to be excused of some bribe.
Oh, my goodness. So do you need any kind of formal warning?
No, this is just an update to let you know we're ready to go live in the next few days.
And then now we'll have the policies in place for next time, so we'll...
Yes.
Okay.
And all our current policies have been added,
yep.
have been, Al, uploaded, have been uploaded onto the new website.
Okay.
And the policy
good.
On the coaches' evaluations
we're
is still in the oven.
We're on that.
We're on it.
Is there any other questions?
I have been,
thank
we're
you.
On it.
Thank you.
Yep.
Ha. I thought we forgot.
Full business now? No.
Yes.
Library referendum student?
Yes. I asked the committee, or I'm asking the committee, for two issues that for you to consider. I believe as a superintendent, one of my jobs is when issues come to the forefront that impact the school department, that we need, or I need to bring them before the school committee for their attention and their review, and in some cases, action. The first issue is we had the folks from the library a couple of weeks ago, maybe a month ago, come, and they made, I think, a wonderful presentation. And I believe, as superintendent of schools, I wrote a letter, and I think most of you may have seen it, so I'm not going to reiterate it, what I said, but the library supports, I believe, what we're trying to do here in the school department. And it's a valuable asset to us. And I believe that if the referendum, if a new library is built, it will only continue to serve and support our students. And I'm just asking the committee if they would want to consider taking a formal position on it. I mean, I did mine as superintendent and gave the explanation, but, you know, I'm putting it before the committee as, you know, is it something that you would like to take an official position on?
What is the committee's pleasure?
I had asked as to the Oracle, Ms. Sally, she has all the documents available to us, and had asked her if previous bonds had been brought before us and the committee as a whole, because we've only been on for so long. And it, as far as she could remember, obviously we did as a committee vote on the school bond, but other bonds had not been brought before us to vote upon. So given our purview within regulations and things of what are we supposed to be doing as a school committee, I went through some of our governances within the state and our own policies, and couldn't find anything that would pertain to us making a formal motion. I'm happy to discuss with everybody's their opinions, but I don't feel that this is something that we should be making a formal motion on. Actually, neither of the agenda items regarding the ballot updates. So I did put together a packet with also the regulations in here, but I'd be happy to speak to the library personally, but I'm not for taking a vote on this.
Well, I would respectfully disagree, particularly in light of some new policies that we unanimously approved last December. And I will read from our school committee's beliefs and responsibilities statement. I will work unremittingly to help my community understand the importance of proper support for public education, whether it be in providing adequate finance, optimum facilities, staffing and resources, or better educational programs for children. And certainly our public library provides educational programs for our children. And also from our code of ethics, which actually references Rhode Island general law, that we must recognize our first and greatest concern must be the educational welfare of the students attending our schools. I think that the public library is certainly one of our most important educational partners in town. When they came and spoke to us about the new project, I mentioned the toddler story times that they provide. They send students to us who arrive in kindergarten reading ready. They provide summer reading programs. I also mentioned them last time, that enable our students to maintain or improve their grade level reading skills over the summer, because we know as educators that students who do not read over the summer lose ground. As I thought about it more, I realized there are many other ways that the library supports our school children and our school programs. If you go to the public library in June or July, any summer, you will see a large display with multiple copies of any book that's on the required reading list for our high school students, so that they do not have to purchase them. The nonfiction collection in our public library has been developed with research projects in mind that our elementary school students, middle school students, and high school students are assigned year after year, whether that's Christmas in you name the country in the world, or ancient Egypt, ancient Greece, U.S. history. The public library invests in materials so that our students can go after school and weekend hours when the schools and the school libraries are not open and complete their research projects. Of course, the library also provides free internet service. They provide printers at a minimal cost per page. I know I've been in that boat where you've run out of ink or you've run out of colored ink, and so you take a quick trip to the public library and print out the student's project or paper. The new building will just expand the kind of support services and opportunities available to our students. There will be, for the first time, group rooms where students who are assigned group projects, and as a parent, we know that happens all the time, students will be able to meet at the library. It will no longer be an issue of, well, whose house are we going to go to now, and where do they live, and how do we get there? And so in light of all of the support that the public library offers our students, and they make it possible for our students to be successful in their schoolwork, I think it's very appropriate for us as a committee to endorse and support this new project. So.
Well, I disagree with Mrs. Herman for many reasons. First of all, we are talking about the building, not the concept of a library. Concept of a library obviously supports the students. We are talking about building a new building. When we put the schools together, when we proposed to the community that we are going to build new schools, one of the arguments which we made, and I want to remind everyone, is that we are building these schools obviously for to be used for instruction of children, but at the same time these buildings are supposed to be used by community at large for different events. So if someone is going to say, well, we need a new building to run particular program for our children in the summer, why not in one of the schools? So what's wrong instead of just walking down the street to Fort Barton and offer a program for the children over there, why do you need a new building to do that? Now, there are programs like art camps run in Pocasset School. What's different about that? We don't need, this happens with Hindi schools, and they were designed to serve for that purpose. I heard arguments about, well, we need a new library, one of the, not just this reason, but, well, the business people who want to come here and want to meet someplace, they don't have a place to meet. I don't buy that. I heard other arguments about, well, we need a better working spaces for our librarians. I do not buy that either. We have no obligations to provide better working spaces for the librarians. So all these arguments which I hear are artificial to me to basically build another building. It's very hard for me to speak on that matter because this is a great group of people who had this dream and for a very long time put this together, and they raised tremendous amount of money and from donations comparing to what they are asking for, but it is still a couple of millions of dollars of taxpayers' money. Now, people talk about, well, the children will come and do homework over there. Which children? The children do the homework, and if you want to do meet as a group, most of the time the kids meet in the houses of other parents when they have hot chocolate and popcorn and have some fun when they are doing it. I don't think they can do this in the library. So obviously, you know, having a meeting, having a community center, maybe, but can we afford it right now? Another issue I have is that I feel that we have to be intellectually honest, because if we are those who actually read and promote libraries. We're supposed to do the research on what are the trends in publishing industry and how people use information. I don't know if anyone noted, but Borders basically went out of business for a particular reason. I don't know if anyone noted, but basically the publishing industry is going through the revolution much larger than what happened when Gutenberg invented the printing press, because this impacted how books are printed, not necessarily how they are consumed. This is all driven by the consumers. To me, this library is a monument to our generation, how we access and how we use the information. If that's what it is, it's a monument to us, and before, as long as we can, for 10 years or whatever we are going to use it, let's be honest that that's what it is. But that's not where the industry is going. So when we have this huge turmoil and this industry does not know basically how they are going to position themselves in terms of how to publish the information and how to make it available to people, we are building a library. It's like building a stagecoach station when everyone is already driving the cars. We have to, it's a wrong time, even so one says it's just $2 million and we are going to get 10 somewhere else, it is still $2 million. And we will have to maintain the building. So all these programs can be run. The world is going to be a virtual library, it's not going to be buildings. Yes, there will be meetings, buildings where people will meet, but not in a traditional sense what the libraries were used for. So I think it's a wrong idea, and I don't think this in general is our business to, I agree with Mrs. Coulter, to basically have a voice in that discussion, because at the same time we can say, well, do the policemen come here and teach children about safety? They do. Well, so maybe we should vote on take a position of buying cruisers for the policemen. What about fire safety? Shall we vote on a fire truck? Maybe we should. This also impacts our children. We have a community. We have these different committees and different bodies here in the government which take care of different parts of that business. And I don't think we should mix all of this, because there is a reason that we should watch for what's important to us. And I just think this library idea, as much as we love these people and I much as love the books, and I probably would go over there, to me it makes no sense from the perspective of the where the industry is going. And it's almost like, let's quickly build this, because in a couple of years we will find out how irrelevant that decision was. Let's quickly do it now, because it's still kind of, we are on the edge when some things are happening. I don't know if you noticed, but you can print now, or you have people are used to us to having a, well, you are not going to read on a computer, it's heavy, it's awkward. Right now you can have displays which you can bend and do things like this. Very shortly, this is already coming. You will print on things which kind of feel like paper. You can have something like this, and this is going to be your display. How are you going to compete with that and a book which is printed and it's going to cost $100 because we are running out of paper and trees? It's going to, the books, traditional books are going to become gifts. Collectibles which you are going to give to someone, at least for the next generation. But we are building a library which kind of is based on our traditional way of looking how we consumed information, what we love. We grew up in libraries, and that's obviously, we love that. But that's not the reason to build something based on your heart and your own traditions. Or we have to look in, how many years are we going to get out of this building? 50? Certainly not 10, am I right? Because it's a stupid investment to do it for 10 years.
Chairman Black, if I might. I disagree with Mr. Burgundy, but I do agree with him that we need to focus on educational issues or things that impact the education. But I do feel this is one that does. We're the Board of Education for this town. We're tasked with that by the state. So things that impact the education of our children, we absolutely, I believe, should take a leadership role. We were elected to do that. we should take a position on it. One of the things that I think we all need to realize is as the funding is cut for schools, these partnerships that we've been investing in, such as collaborations for oil, collaborations for supply, these partnerships are going to be more and more important to us. And one of those partnerships that we can take advantage of is our public library. We haven't been able to because of the limited amount of people that could actually fit in that building. But there can be partnerships that we have with the public library that are going to allow us to use our resources more efficiently. It's going to allow us to do things that we couldn't spend our own money to do. I think the book talks are an excellent example of yes, you don't have to do them in the library, but it's a very convenient place when you have a book that your entire accelerated ELA is working on, and they all meet at the library. I think we have a program now where we have a teacher who's facilitating letter writing between Tiverton, England, and Tiverton, Rhode Island. What a great opportunity to go over there and use their conferencing capability to conference between those children. I just think there's as Bill said so eloquently in his letter, it was very well done, there's a natural connection. I think there's savings and there's opportunities we're going to be able to offer our children that we don't now because of this building. And I do think investing in educational infrastructure, which is what this is something that we should be taking a position on.
Could I just answer a couple of, I know I already used my time, but in terms of conferencing, the kids do it every night on their laptop, talking to other kids. The times when special facilities had to be provided for this are far gone. Two, I strongly object to we ask students to do a research on a particular topic, and we require students to use particular type of media for the reference as opposed to judging what is the quality of this reference, how relevant is this to the paper. So the teacher tells the students, because this teacher was educated using books and paper, and there has to be a reference which is a printed book. It cannot be all internet. Where is all the information? All information is out there. There will be never a book which is printed on the trends in publishing, because this changes so quickly that there's no time to actually edit this type of publication and present it to someone. All research journals, nothing is available in hard copy anymore. It's all done through the computers. And the new generation is growing with these technologies. We don't like it. I personally don't like it, but this doesn't matter, because I will not be here in 20 years. I will be 6 feet under, or maybe they will put me even deeper for everything I said. But I will be gone, and these kids will rule. And now mom is going to bring, because mom liked printed books, and say, Johnny, you are going to go with me and read in a summer program in Tiverton Library, and I will sign you up for this. And Johnny has to walk. But when Johnny is on his own in college, Johnny is going to say, Mommy, sorry, let me just use my phone here, which I can bend and put in my pocket. It's like a piece of paper, and here it is. I have anything I want. The world is a library. Now, we have to have a building for that, am I right? And what's going to happen in these buildings? If they are going to be meeting rooms, but that's not where the library is going to be, where it's going right now. But we still look back what we like and how
we use
information.
And again, you have your opinion, I have mine. I respect it, and I think we've both made our points. Perhaps
sure. Mrs. Black.
Do I have a motion?
Did you want to speak, Mrs. Black?
I'll make a motion that we support the upcoming library bond on November 8th.
I'll second the motion.
All in favor?
Oh, you can have.
I'm sorry. Does anyone want to speak? If I start speaking, we'll be here till midnight, so I'm going to be quiet. Does anyone want to say anything about it? I think you've probably all seen my things in the paper, and I've been door to door and chatting with everyone.
Okay.
I'm very passionate about this. So. All those in favor? Oh, go ahead.
I guess they kind of go together, and I kind of wrote it all.
Can you read it during the next one, and was it after the motion, or? Okay.
Do you want to
No, she said she can do it after we take the motion.
Okay, all those in favor?
So she can just do it all together and it won't be split.
Okay, all those in favor? Okay. All those against?
The second issue, the financial town referendum, I'm asking the committee to consider taking a position because, as you're well aware, over the summer, actually in the spring and summer, we had four meetings where part of the meeting was dedicated to the financial town referendum. Mr. Karen and Mrs. Driggs came before us and presented their proposal. During those meetings, we expressed concerns, what I would call procedural concerns, as well as legal concerns, and in the final product that was eventually approved to go before the voters, our concerns and legal issues really were never addressed and are still outstanding. And I would like, if the chair would allow, I would just like to talk about, again, kind of just summarize what some of the procedural issues are, and then Attorney Robinson can speak to the legal, if that's okay. The first concern that we addressed, and that I have, and I believe if approved, the FTR can negatively impact us in what we're trying to do as a school department. And from a procedural standpoint, one of the first issues that stands out that still is the, in 301A, final approval of the budget. The school department, according to the proposal, would have to submit a budget 63 days prior to the FTR, to the actual vote. My calculations puts that into about mid-March. As the committee well knows, and then if, just to back up, if we wanted to put an optional budget forward, for whatever reason, we would have to do it 37 days before the FTR, which would be about mid-April. As the committee knows, we have a hard time currently, under the current system, of getting accurate data and narrowing it down so that when we go before the voters, we're as confident as possible with our number. Some of the things, if this were to pass and we were to provide a budget, a final budget, 63 days, that is mid-March, to the budget committee, our state aid number, even though there's a funding formula, is still never approved until the end of June. That is always, especially now in our fiscal times that we're experiencing, that's still in play. Last year, I believe we were fortunate to be funded to the number that they said they were going to fund us at. Our federal monies are still in flux. We still have issues regarding enrollment. Sometimes that goes into flux in staffing issues. And I just believe the way it's structured now is that the numbers that we would be putting forward will not be as accurate as what we currently do. And if we had our druthers, and I believe I mentioned this in one of the meetings, is that if anything, it should be later, towards June, when we have our numbers, our financial numbers from the state. And that way voters would know, or at least we would be able to put our budget together with a higher degree of certainty. Right now, we do the best we can. In my opinion, if we have to push it to March, that's really just a shot in the dark, because under this process, that's it. That's the number that you were required to put that number in. There is a hearing, a hearing 2 weeks prior to the proposed FTR, but that's just to review the budget numbers. Currently, right now, there have been times where we've adjusted our number the day of a town meeting, before we've gone into a town meeting, because we've been making cuts to our budget. That all goes away under this proposal. The other issue that I believe has a direct impact on us is the fact that petitions can be made and put on the ballot. It takes just 50 signatures according to the proposal. I couldn't find any language in the proposal that addresses who reviews the validity of the proposals that go forward. And by that, I mean, someone could hypothetically, if they get the 50 signatures, put a budget together that cuts us $1 million. Now, we couldn't function with a $1 million cut. In fact, it would be illegal because you got to give us at least a dollar more. But there's no provision in here from keeping, that I read, to keep that from happening. In fact, at the hearing, I don't think there's even a requirement for people, if they meet the criteria, to come and defend their budget. So the number can be put forward. Then you have in 301E1, at the hearing, you have the possibility of no one coming to defend it, but then when you go to vote, our number, if it doesn't get the majority of votes, and it's the second top vote getter, we go into a runoff. But hypothetically, our number might not make the cut. In other words, it could be we could be the third highest vote getter, our budget number, and then our budget number wouldn't appear on the ballot, the final vote. So our say, what we do, which is to provide an adequate education for children under this process, can be pushed to the side by the way it's set up. Right now, we go before the town voters. They vote on a number. Sometimes it's an agreement with the budget committee, sometimes it's not. But our number is there. And if someone does make amendments from the floor, they get debated on the floor. There's no such, you know, that all seems to not be there anymore. So those are the procedural issues. And Steve, you want to touch on your legal issues?
I'll try to summarize, because we went back and there were meetings, it appeared there were meetings in May and June here before the committee. I know Mr. Karen came and made a presentation to the committee, and at that time there were questions raised about some of the language that caused us concern as your attorneys. Probably, and I won't go through each and every one of them because there are several pages of concerns, but the one that probably stands out the most is the one we just finished litigating before the Board of Regents on Monday, and that is bifurcating the budget. The law is clear, and I'll go through a presentation to the committee on that. And 301B1A appears to perpetuate the position that's been taken by the council that, yes, we can bifurcate. It's not clear, an appropriation. It doesn't say a total appropriation. That question was put to Mr. Karen at his presentation in June 20th and on May 10th. To my knowledge, there's been no satisfactory resolution of that issue. I think it needs to be clear that it needs to be an overall allocation. I think the law is very clear in that regard, and leaving it intentionally ambiguous is not, it's just not a good thing. People should be clear on what this means. The optional budget proposal, I won't go into it, it's fairly lengthy, but it's not clear to me. It seems as if the school committee now has to prepare a municipal budget on this optional proposal. what numbers get put into it, what happens with the optional, it's to me, it's very unclear. That was brought to the attention of the committee on July 11th by Mrs. Herman, and by myself, Ms. Black and Ms. Palace both addressed that, the optional question, which has not to today, from our review of the records, been any satisfactory response to that. 301E4, financial town hearing. The clerk is going to equitably facilitate the financial town hearing agenda. We were concerned, what does that mean? Who gets to speak? How long do they get to speak? Is there any, how does that work? That again was brought to the attention of the group on June 20th, 2011, and still has not been addressed. Going over the cap, we had serious concerns about how that was, the language proposed was going to mesh with state law. It does not appear to mesh well.
Can you just expound on that a little?
Well, the question is, a financial town referendum, there is no reference to it in the levy statute. So what is it? Is it going to be considered under financial town meeting? Financial town meeting, the voters can exceed the cap, but can they do it on a financial town referendum? It's not mentioned in the statute. It's an ambiguity, is what I'm getting at. and that needs to be resolved. The courts might say, yes, a financial town referendum is, in fact, a financial town meeting. But that's not clear to me. That, once again, was Ms. Durfee brought that to the board's attention in July, and I believe Ms. Palish as well brought that up. If the town doesn't get the approval before the timing of the financial town referendum, what happens? So they have to apply to the state for certain approvals of exceeding the cap. Section 800A gave us pause. Print, advertise the town clerk, and distribute the docket and any qualified budget proposals or resolutions. To whom do these get distributed to and how? It seems to be, it could be a large number of proposals put on this ballot. Once again, one of the things that this was again brought to the board's attention in July, which has not been addressed. Another matter that came up at this was section 1218, which was left intact. That's where it's been suggested that committee members might not be able to speak or act on this. It's clearly an unconstitutional provision in the charter. It's clearly a broad attempt. It could be perceived as a broad restriction on the school committee's right to speak. That was brought to the board's attention in July and in June by Ms. Black, Mr. Burke, and that has not been addressed. There are other things, but that's all I can tell you is from our perspective as your attorneys, there are many, many concerns I have over the language we have looked at, which have not been addressed, and accordingly, I can't recommend to you that you support it in its present form.
And Bill, what's your recommendation?
My recommendation to the committee is that they take a position, and my position is based first and foremost on our legal opinion, but also on the procedural issues that I mentioned as well. I you know, our attorneys strongly believes that the issues haven't been answered. I agree with them. I think it would negatively impact us in its current form, and I'm asking the committee to take a position on the ballot.
And what is the committee's budget? We made our wage.
Okay, so I'm going to read my long letter. Apologize for the length. It's both issues together because I feel they go hand in hand. When I was looking up the different information regarding, again, our purview, one of the things that stood out was the adoption of the school budget by the school committee to submit to the local appropriating. Appropriating authority. As we're coming up with our budgets, it seemed to me that the process would be similar to what we've currently done, going back and forth. Yes, the date would be earlier, but we're still giving it to our appropriating body, whomever that may be, whether that be the FTM, the FTR, or whomever we submit our numbers to. That's our part is the part prior to that occurring. So, to whom it may concern, I'm writing to attach my statements with our minutes from today's meeting. I have a few concerns that I'd like to be documented. While I appreciate hearing various opinions on the upcoming ballot questions, I do not feel that the formal vote of advocacy is within our purview as a school committee. These referendum questions are for our 12,000 voters to decide. I have looked within our state regulations that govern school committees and the internal Tiverton policies to find a link to this external measure and found none. Historically, according to Mrs. Black, the school committee did take a formal motion on the bond related to the building of the new grade schools, but to no other bonds. As for the other ballot issue regarding the replacement of the financial town meeting, the school committee did not take a vote 2 years ago when the last proposal to replace the financial town meeting was put before the people, and I do not think we should be setting such precedents. Attached are the state regulations pertinent to our school committee policies. These upcoming ballot decisions are those of the people and have no bearing on the evaluation of performance, care and control, employment policy, master plan of education, school facility adoption, and it goes through the full 20 regulations that we have. In addition, I went through our local policies, that is for later. Though I do feel that we can and should discuss under the portion that allows us to make public relevant institutional information in order to promote communication and understanding between our school system and the community, and not to take a formal vote either way. This being said, I'd like to state that the educational welfare of our students is all of our primary concern, and that the library would allow for additional work area for the children to have after school meeting places to work on papers and such. I would also like to document my praise for the library committee's efforts to obtaining alternate funding sources besides the people of Tiverton. Prior to sitting at this table, I would have said, well, of course, the state will come through with their promises. Since then, I've seen numbers change drastically. So adamantly, I have internal reservations regarding the funding portion coming from the state. I always assumed that what they said was going to be the case, and things are not always necessarily what they say from the get-go. So I do have slight reservations given the funding on that portion for the library. Regarding the second upcoming ballot question, I'd also like to address Mr. Rearick's statement within our packet as to his reasoning to the placement on this agenda. He states that the supporters of the financial town referendum have not adequately addressed the school committee's concerns, and he believed that a vote should be taken as to whether or not the school committee should endorse this proposal. As far as I'm concerned, I didn't feel that that was an adequate statement, given that the prior financial town referendum proposal that the school committee did not vote upon, the school committee and the superintendent were invited in 2007 for the committee, for the FTR committee, to hear concerns from the school committee and the superintendent. But after that, there was no back and forth regarding that. And the financial town meeting changes advisory has come before our committee multiple times with presentations, answering our questions and taking our concerns back to their committee. They were here the 26th of April, May 10th, May 24th, and June 20th, and our minutes show that no action or votes were taken on the changes that were presented, although there was a lively debate with question and answer sessions. On each occasion that they were before us, they asked what our concerns were, and often the answer was that the finished product needed to be seen before input would be granted. As we would tell our students, that's a backwards way to proceed. To wait until there is a finished product and then deconstruct makes no sense. We were asked for our feedback during the formative stages, and to wait until week one before the ballot election is non-collaborative at best. As noted in my recent letter to the editor, I'm in favor of the financial town referendum. There are many reasons that I feel this way. Through ballot voting versus hand-raising, all-day access to the ballot, absentee ballots, etc. These are more important where many parents can't spend all day at a town meeting. Additionally, if a parent advocacy group were to decide that additional monies were needed to fund a particular program or project, they could additionally gather their 50 signatures and advocate for this program prior to the ballot voting day. This advance notification would allow a longer period to express the need for a particular issue and fully explain this to the public. Haven't you ever sat in an FTM and wondered regarding motions from the floor, where'd they come up with that number, and what would the benefit of that extra money be? Now you would know weeks in advance, and the financial town meeting referendum would allow for all of our parents to have a voice. The town council has not made a recommendation to endorse, nor should we. Leave this to the voters of Tiverton.
Matt, can I just address 2 points that Danielle mentioned? Regarding taking positions on the bonds, I believe there's only been 3 bonds in the last 15 years. The TIF bond, the high school bond, and the elementary bond, now the library bond. The TIF bond was never a public discussion. That was a previous town councils years ago. They did that on their own. They took their own votes and approved that. We did support, previous council committees did support the high school bond and the elementary bond. So that's all that I'm aware of, that at least in the last 15 years as far as bonds go. Regarding the issue of the previous, when the Charter Review Commission asked us to come, first of all, they invited us to come. They scheduled time for us to voice our concerns, which we did. The proposals that came out of that, the committee at that time, different group of people, except for, I think for Sally, I'm not, and I think Jan was here, but a different composition of this committee, determined that what the proposal was something that was already been vetted. Other districts had been using it and felt no need to comment on it. So they chose not to. So that's why there was no action. So just to give some context, I've been here too long because I can go back that far, but if I could just kind of clarify that.
Yes,
thank you.
When I spoke to Danielle today, I explained to her that the bonds, of course, we would support. The school bonds would go door to door and chat with everyone we could, and we did. And the TIF bond was a bond voted on by the town council. It was never a referendum to the people. Tax incremental finance bond, an $8 million bond for the sewer till 2022, that was voted on by the town council. Nobody had any input to that. So that was what I said. And then as I told her, the last Charter Review Commission had an amazing, they invited everyone in town. Everyone had a time to come, even the Arts Commission and Open Space, and everybody came and they talked to them and then they'd have them back. But the thing that was on the ballot, which was 2008, we just went along with the 4,182 people that said not to vote for it. That was the thing that came at the very end for the town council to be in charge with the safety valve of a referendum with signatures if you didn't like what the town council had. So that's what came out of that Charter Review Commission. People here present were on that, so they can speak to that. But just, yeah, that was it. Thank you. Okay, who else? Mr. Burgundy?
May I?
Of course.
I know you're hesitating. Allow
me. No, I'm not hesitating. That's why we have a democracy.
But in my key, democracy should be restricted.
No,
absolutely not.
Not on this board.
Okay, I just want to address some of the concerns about this referendum versus financial town meeting. To me, was Mr. Rarick mentioned the procedural issues, which is that only 50 signatures are sufficient to basically present a budget. And as you remember, I thought that probably a higher number would be appropriate, but 50 is much better than one. And 50 is much better than 50 is much better, which we have right now. And 750 each is much better than people racing to a microphone and different political and other groups strategizing how are we going to sit around on the bleachers around the microphone so our people can be the closest to the microphone and block the other group. This is more appropriate for football than for financial town meeting, but that's what we are having right now, and that's what we are replacing with something. So to me, this is not a concern that 50 people, I wish it would require more than just 50 signatures, but that's certainly better than what we have. Now, in terms of the timeline, this is of a concern. So now, could you please maybe to remind everyone, compare these two timelines, the timeline as it stands right now in terms of our financial, our budgetary process versus the one we will have to obey by if financial town referendum.
The process that we follow now is the school committee needs to submit its budget on or about the third Friday-ish of January.
Preliminary
budget to the budget committee. We do not meet with the budget committee. Our first meeting is usually mid to late March. This year was earlier. It was early March for whatever reason.
Would this change in the new format?
Well, it would change in the sense that we would have to have a final budget. That is our final document in by 63 days prior to the FTR, which is mid-April. Our final document doesn't get finalized. We voted, I believe, on April 25th of this past April for a final number that we went to the budget committee with to say, yes, this is our final number.
Correct.
That would no, again, from reading the document, that doesn't occur anymore. We don't amend because our number has to be put forward on that date. That's the final, it says final budget proposal.
You said mid-April. The final budget to the budget committee goes mid-March.
Under the proposal.
Right. If we want to do an optional budget.
That goes to mid-April?
That's mid-April. The budget committee has to use the one that we submit.
Right.
Mid-March.
I believe so. So, I mean, the time, it's pushed up. And we're already pressed to provide the accurate data now. And now we're saying, fine, when you see final budget, well, you know, a lot of people already accuse us, quite frankly, of overspending, or we spend too much. Well, we do our best to try to make sure the number is accurate. And if you're pushing it forward, the dates that the data's got to be in,
There are a lot of unknowns.
They'll become more unknowns. That's correct. That could impact our budget.
So, basically, to me, this is a serious argument here. Now, as far as legal issues are concerned, where are we right now? We are arguing on legal stuff no matter what happens. Am I right? We'll be in courts in this town. It doesn't matter. Financial town meeting or referendum makes no difference. We will be in courts.
I believe because there are legal issues regarding the proposal. And I don't want my request. I believe personally, for whatever it's worth, I'm not a resident, but having experienced 14 or 15 FTMs being the focal point of a lot of people's anger, the process is broken. Mm. There's no question. My concern is that the proposal that's put forward to the committee has issues that can negatively impact us. And I think, you know, I just don't think we should, we can support that. Because if, once it's passed, if it's approved, and we don't take a position, it's going to be turned on the school department and the school committee and say, you guys didn't say anything. Well, we did say things. We said it at four different meetings. And because they were never resolved to our satisfaction. So we did provide the input. They just weren't, you know, approved by the people that were reviewing it.
But do you agree that at the end, we are under obligation to fulfill our responsibilities as a school committee, which means provide education to the kids and properly fund that? No matter what kind of system anyone invents.
Yes.
And if this pure democracy, I think it's much more democratic that everyone in privacy of the booth can say, I vote for this versus that, versus everyone watches a neighbor what they are going to do. So I think this is much more democratic. But people right now go and vote on things without understanding what these numbers mean. They don't attend any meetings of the budget committee. So right now people vote like that. Now, this financial town referendum will suffer from the same problems, that people will basically vote on numbers and they will choose not to attend the sessions where the issues will be discussed and the different groups will be able to explain why am I putting this type of proposal.
But they don't have to explain it.
Well, right now no one has to explain anything. Well, no,
we
because
do.
I send, I will,
we explain our
I
number.
I understand, but if
and
someone's
so
going
does
to
the
say zero.
Committee. Right, but then there's a debate. Currently,
yeah.
Good, bad, or indifferent on the floor of the town
we
meeting.
Have opportunity to explain
people,
what this would mean.
Right. We have an opportunity, and quite frankly, a lot of the amendments that have been made in the last few years have been hostile to the school committee. If I remember correctly, they've been hostile to
except
us.
Except Palash Amendment.
Well, except the Palash Amendment, as you refer to it, back in 2010. But
I'm
several,
hostile, just not
but just. It was my train of thought. But for the most part, most have been hostile for whatever it's worth. So that's just, you can everyone review the tapes on that.
I think that the issue is much bigger than all of this. Because there's a few other things on the agenda which we'll be discussing, which concern money. How the money, which money basically belongs to for education of the children, and which money might be is questionable whether we are voting on the whole budget or versus we can partition what town provides, et cetera, et cetera. We will be in this until the judges are going to make final decisions.
The point is, we shouldn't have to be there.
I understand.
And you know, the bifurcation issue, if there's a legal issue that I ask the committee to consider, is that the bifurcating of the number is not addressed in the FTR.
Mm-hmm.
It's not. We just received the ruling from the Board of Regents, the subcommittee, and once that's approved by the full board, we'll have the commissioner's two rulings, the Board of Regents rulings, saying that you can't do that.
Sure.
So I'm saying to you as the committee, how can you put forward or not take a position on language we know isn't correct? We know that. Our attorney's telling us that. We've been to the, we just got out of a Board of Regents meeting on Monday on that very point. So all the other concerns he's talking about are all valid. The most important in my mind is the bifurcating point, because that's why we're having the lawsuits, is that debate. And excuse me, not even lawsuits. The only lawsuit will come if there's appeal of the Board of Regents decision.
Yeah.
Well, but we'll save that.
Could I just bring it back to 2009 for a moment, please? And everyone says to me 50 signatures, as you just said, it is better than one amendment. But what I want to point out is in real time right now, at the financial town meeting, coming back to 09, when a person made an amendment for a number, Mr. Tites, who is not our lawyer, he's the town lawyer, said, do not vote on that amendment. It's illegal. It's not a dollar more than the year before. Everyone in that room that was going to raise their hand or not knew, don't vote on that. They found out in real time. Save us a lot of problems, a lot of legal money, a lot of suing and everything else. Okay, so then we lost that vote by 5 votes. And you on the stage immediately said as chairperson, we would like to go for a paper private ballot. Out in the lobby, the Eagles are all set up, water canvases, bang, it's done. That vote failed. Today it's so sacred. That day it wasn't so sacred. It failed to go in the private ballot by 5 votes. Who knows which way it would have gone. That was huge. It was a $625,000 cut to the school committee. Now I'll bring you to this year. I was up on the stage this year. Didn't like it very much, but I had to be there. And so I could look out on the crowd, and the gentleman stood up and he said, I'd like to cut $325,000 from the school budget, and I want it to come from the teachers. And I looked out on the crowd, and there were a lot of little, yeah, okay, good, you know, teachers get too much, well, that's a good idea. And then Mr. Rarick in real time said, you can't do that. The teachers have a contract. That's illegal. It'll come from the programs. Right away, I looked out, the faces were, oh, no, I don't want to do that. So there's two very concrete examples of how, and of course, we all know it's broken, something could be better. But in real time, we avoided a lot of problems by the people finding out that the budget they were about to raise their hand on was illegal.
I understand.
Do you want to hear it? Will the committee entertain those?
Oh, surely.
Sure, let's take
I mean, my recommendation, I guess. And then.
Thank you very much, Jeff Caron, a co-chair of the former committee. I first of all want to echo some of the things that member Coulter stated about that we came before you 4 times. And all 4 times we came here to get your input. And we had to read through the tea leaves for the most part, okay? And we were told a couple of times that we want to see the final proposal. And I said, well, you want to see the final proposal, you can see the final proposal, and it's almost done. So I just want to say that there was an extreme effort to try to vet this with the school committee, and that the Charter Advisors Committee did its best. Secondly, I really don't know, I really question the intellectual honesty of the conversation that led this off between the Superintendent Rarick and Mr. Robinson. Because I got the opportunity to read both legal opinions of Mr. Robinson, and I can go right down the list and say, yes, this proposal addresses every single thing he put in writing. The one area that remains possibly a concern is the area of the bifurcation. And the bifurcation issue, as drafted, can go either way, just like it can now. Okay? So to say that this is illegal is not true. It means it has more latitude, perhaps, but it's certainly not illegal. I really, really find fundamental issues with the first two speakers in this conversation. We addressed all the issues. The school committee or Mr. Rarick
Mrs. Black, the speaker should not be yelling at the count at the committee.
The school committee or Mr. Rarick or Mr. Robinson may not be very happy with all the decisions the committee made, but that's this committee's job. But we address them all, okay, and every single one of those. So I don't know why Attorney Robinson now comes up with and regurgitates the list that he had, adds a few more things that he's already had the chance to review, and then says that there's legal issues. I just don't get it. I'd also like to say that essentially what you're asking, and what seems like to me from what the superintendent asked, is you want to have it both ways. We don't want to give any input. We'll just slow roll them. And then what we'll do at the end is we'll sandbag them. That's what I hear. And what I think this committee really needs to think about, frankly, on this whole subject is the parents. How about the parents? How about the parents who have to go sit through that meeting and do that for 4 hours? Catechism, baseball, soccer, all the sports. Has there been a shred of consideration for the parents? Essentially, if this vote is taken tonight, I'm going to just say it flat out. It's a declaration of war of this school committee on the parents and the taxpayers of Tiverton.
Thank you, Mr.
Jay Lambert, Sunset View Drive, Tiverton, Rhode Island. As you know, I'm a member of the town council. I'm the president of the town council, and I'm not here addressing you as a council member. I'm not here addressing you as the president of the town council. After listening to all of this, sure. Does the microphone work?
That okay. Is not a microphone. That's going to be television.
Okay. Well, I'll try to keep my voice up. I'm going to tell you that in a couple of weeks from now, I'm going to vote for the FTR. I will vote yes. And on the issue of the library, I'm going to vote yes. And that simply represents my personal opinion. And if you look back and see what the town council has done in getting these issues before the taxpayers and the voters, we had a number of hearings. And after due consideration, a majority of the town council made the decision that both of those issues should go to the taxpayers and the voters of Tiverton. And I think that was our responsibility. You've also had the benefit, I think, of understanding what the personal thinking is of perhaps a majority of the town council. The question really here for tonight is, should this school committee be voting as a school committee one way or the other on the FTR or the library issue? I tried to make it clear when I was president of the town council that I thought it was inappropriate that the town council, as a town council, take a position on the library issue. And I felt it was inappropriate that the town council take a position as a town council on the FTR. The argument that you've heard here tonight, I think, is the best possible argument that I could make that this isn't school committee business. You're getting involved in politics. And as I told one of the members earlier, just before the meeting, I'm going to quote Louise Durfee. She was always making the caution to me, you're on a slippery slope. Where is this all going to lead? And I ask you to consider, at least on the FTR issue, where is it going to lead? I understand the arguments that have been made about supporting the library. You have a similar mission. You have a mission of education. You can't make that argument when you're talking about the FTR. If my notes are correct, Mr. Rerich, and by the way, I would actually support his comments, and I think they were good comments when he was speaking in terms of the library. But when speaking about the FTR, it seems his criteria is, and I think I have it correct, does it have a direct impact on the schools? Does it have a negative impact on the schools? Could it impact on the schools? Now, is that really the criteria that the school committee should be using in addressing what are obviously political issues? The town council thought it totally inappropriate, and I thought it personally totally inappropriate, for a town council to tell the voters how to vote on an issue like this. What you're doing is getting involved in political issues. That's not your business. And ask the question that Louise Durfee would ask, and that is, where are you going on the slippery slope? Because I can tell you where you're going. You make a decision on a political issue like this, what's your position on the wind turbines? What's your position on no bins, no barrels? What's your position on pay-as-you-throw? And what's your position going to be as to whether or not the present town council should be re-elected next year? And what objection are you going to have if this town council says, replace this school committee, replace this school administration? Where do you end off? What criteria are you using other than Mr. Rerich's criteria of direct impact? Obviously, anything that this school committee does or this school administration does has an impact on the town. Using that criteria, there'd be absolutely no political limit at all to the town council as to what positions we can take, either for or against anything that this administration is doing on the school side or any positions that this school committee is taking on the school side. That is my concern tonight. And I think that the argument that you've heard so far proves my point. You can't even agree among yourselves as to what the political consideration is. You obviously cannot make any determination as to what the legal issues are. What you're simply doing is making a politically expedient decision. That's it. And I suspect if you pass a resolution like this, you're going to live to regret it.
Thank you, Mr. Lambert.
No, please, guys, we don't clap here. This isn't a sporting event.
Town council doesn't have sporting events either.
I think I'm putting my wife in a recusal situation. I
think you can talk.
Good evening, members of the committee, staff of the school department. My name is Rob Coulter. As many of you know, I'm a member of the town council, a former vice chair of the budget committee, and know a thing or two about the school committee as well. I'm very reluctant to force a recusal for Danielle, but I feel very strongly about this issue, and I'm going to try as best as I can to, and frankly, nobody can hear her anyway, so it doesn't really matter if she's in. That was a joke. There's a little bit of misinformation out there, so I just want to hit some of the topics that I think might at least bridge the gap a little bit in the event that you do make a decision to make an endorsement decision. The financial town meeting change advisory committee has 6 volunteers. I've seen them, they've addressed over 100 items. As you know, they've been here many times. One of the things that I don't think it's stressed enough is that this proposal actually takes some power away from the town council and gives it to school committees, the budget committees, and the voters. And one of the ways that it does that is it compels the town council to apply for state waivers. Right now, there is no obligation on the town council to go up to the Department of Revenue and apply for a state waiver, and the charter would force it. So you are not going to be in a situation where a majority of the town council can refuse. So if a parent group says, you know what, I want more money for the schools, let's take, for example, just yesterday, I was a little late, but I think you covered the same territory, $1.4 million pension contribution. That is the tax cap. That is the entire tax cap right there if that is not reformed. I could easily see an organization of parents coming and say, we need to break the cap, and that pension is a reason that we can do it. The town council could not block applying for that waiver where we could do that now, and I think that's very important. The FTR proposal still gives the school committee access to the ballot, which of course it is required to have by statute to go to its appropriating authority. I think that it's been already covered many grounds about how I believe that this is protective of parents, those that have family commitments. One of my favorite things about this proposal is the provision for absentee ballots. And I appreciate how important it is at times to be able to stand up and have a real-time debate, but you cannot do that and still have absentee ballots. That is such an important thing in our democracy that people that are not present still have the chance to be heard. The advance warning is something we do need to, it concerns me that there seems to, that you think it might be a virtue to be able to have less last second changes, and I would respectfully submit that that is one of the largest problems that we have. Somebody getting up at the microphone and cutting a budget or raising a budget, albeit there's some debate right then and there, but it would be better to have calm and deliberate debate at a financial town hearing with at least 2 weeks of debate back and forth. And I think that that would be a much more thorough and rational way to go about handling it. I should say, too, that certainly the moderator of a financial town meeting could rule something out of order, but we all know that it only takes a majority vote to overturn the moderator. So you really, at the end of the day, are in the exact same situation where illegal budgets, and nobody's ever explained to me who's going to determine, who would get to decide whose budget is legal or not. Mr. Robinson and Mr. Tite certainly can't decide on what a legal budget would be. Mr. Tite and I can't decide what a legal budget would be. Who would get that? And keep in mind that whoever has that decision is essentially taking away power from the people, and that's very important. I think Mr. Lambert really knocked out why I don't think it's an appropriate thing to do to take a vote today. But I do want to stress that, I think I've utterly failed. I really do. But I have tried as best as I can, because I've sat on a couple different boards, to try to bridge some gaps. And things from solar panels to drainage to fighting over paving to this bifurcation lawsuit. Website design, I've asked Mrs. Black, I've emailed Mr. McGondy, trying to collaborate on these things. There's so many things where we just don't seem to be working together. I know the Fall River tuition is coming up later. And I really don't know that it's a good idea to add yet another source of tension between the school board and the town council. And I don't know that we want to just add more tension to a relationship that we're trying so hard to work on. Those are my sort of general points. More specifically to Mr. Rierich's comments, as we know with any budgets, we always have to estimate as best as we can all the time. And whether that's in May or December, you're always going to be into that boat. The 50 signatures, you may or may not know that all that it takes to get a resolution on the financial town meeting resolution docket now is 50 signatures. And I have seen a scenario while I was on the budget committee where we thought we had an illegal resolution, and the advice of the clerk and the solicitor was, don't touch it. Who gets to decide? You can't touch it. Make the argument, and if something turns out wrong, then you'll have to handle it after the fact. You know as well as I do that you always have recourse through a CRULO action if something illegal passes or if you're not getting your needs met. And as far as who's running the hearing, Mr. Robinson, it would be the same way that the Budget Committee runs hearings now. They're required to have hearings, and it would be the same way that our moderator would run a financial town meeting. There's just no reason to think that that wouldn't happen. And just on my last page here, I do have a suggestion. I don't mean to be flip about this, but if you ever were in the scenario where you thought you had to budget conservatively so that you ended up with more money, let's say you thought that state aid was going to be $5 million and we hit the lottery and ended up being $6 million, you can always give that money back. You can always hold it in the reserves. You can always pay down the school bonds. It's not, the end of the world. And so my last point is to remember that none of us, including me, are 100% happy with this proposal. And that's why it is, as with most things in life, it is a compromise. And it is a major leap forward and a step in the right direction. And it can be changed. It can be tweaked. If we need to raise 50 signatures to 100, that's certainly easy to do once we have the benefit of experience. So I would just remember that this is a compromise effort and really something that I think can build the community and sort of bring us back together instead of this infighting. Thank you for your allowing me to walk so long.
Thank you, Mr. Coulter.
Yes, ma'am.
No, thank you. Thank you. Just to address the last comment you made about if we ever got more money, we could, give it back, which we can't do because it has to stay in the school, but we can use it for our next year's budget.
Right.
And we've done that as I've been here for 8 years. If we had something left and we found out it was two to be left, we put it to the next year's budget. Unfortunately, then, some people take that away, but that's what we do, because we are very conscious. Now, the other thing is, you speak about getting together and working together. Well, I've been here, as I said, for 8 years. I've been at the budget committee meetings from January to May for 9 years, probably missed one. In 2004, there were 1,018 people at the town meeting because it was contentious. There was a lot of infighting back and forth, so it filled up that room. The next year, 666 people. Then we all got together. We really got together. The budget committee with Chris Carter, town council with Louise Durkee Dunbar, and us. We got together and we said, this is crazy. We can't keep doing this. Then we really worked things out. We came to a budget we could all agree upon. And we could trust that that budget that was voted on that night in the budget committee would be brought to the floor. Then there were 320 people. Then the next meeting is the meeting we talked about we had to call people. The reason we had to call people is because we all agreed. That was an amazing time in this town. Let me tell you, I was here. So, you know, I can tell you it can happen. I hope it can happen again, and it has happened in the past. So is there anyone else from the audience that would like to speak? Mr. Nelson.
Good evening. Thank you, Sally. This is really about a reform effort that goes back more than a decade. So this town, I think, has recognized that in some years, having 200 people or less vote on a budget is now more than $40 million, isn't a modern way of handling our budget. That budget reform is really a community-based activity. Since we've been working on it for a year, well, the committee has, there have been multiple opportunities for this school committee to step forward and influence the process. What I saw from Mr. Rerich and from Mr. Robinson could very well be a description of a lot of the activities that are taking place at the current FTM and the way it's handled today. We all know that it's broken. We know that. So as Mr. Coulter said, this is really a compromise, and there were a lot of choices that needed to be made. It's not going to make everybody happy. It didn't make me happy across the board. It certainly did not. However, I have to also agree with the President Lambert, and that is that this is a politically motivated activity. The deadline for influencing the actual content has long since passed. So for you to be doing that this evening suggests that the school committee knows better about their own interests, even if it's at the expense of the majority of taxpayers in town. So what are we seeing now? This dirty fight out in the open. Doesn't behoove anybody. I withdrew my ordinance for a tax cap because during that night, a number of you came to me and said, what about this referendum? So I withdrew that. I really thought that there would be a community-based effort to make this happen. I still hope it can. I encourage you to not take a politically motivated step and vote against the taxpayers for this FTR that this town has been trying to accomplish for more than a decade. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Nancy Driggs, I was co-chair with Jeff Caron on the Changes Advisory Committee, and I would just like to applaud President Lambert for his wisdom and sort of understanding what's going on here right now, and agree that it is a political. And to verify what Jeff Caron said, that I also recall several times being before you and looking for information and guidance and hearing those words, well, we want to see the final product. I actually remember Mrs. Coulter one night saying, don't you understand they're looking for our input, and it was not forthcoming. I also remember, in all honesty, coming several times, and Mr. Robinson was working off version 2 when we already were on version 7, that kind of a thing. So I would ask this committee to really think about the fact that you were not part of the process in coming up with this. The time is over. The vote is 10 days away. I agree with Mr. Nelson, and I think taking a vote right now is nothing but political. Thank you.
Laura Epke, thank you for the time, Mrs. Black. I intend to be short. I am not going to use this platform to pick apart the FTR for as many things as has been stated up here in favor the beneficial qualities of the financial town referendum. I can pick as many or more out that I see as detrimental and harmful. Most of all, I do not see this as a healing venture for the town. My fear and my greatest concern is that the FTR, if passed, would divide the town even more than it is now. That said, I am a taxpayer. I expect and elect my school committee to carry out their responsibilities for the care and education of the children of Tiverton. If this school committee feels that a proposed framework will impair their ability to fund education in this town, I expect them to speak up and take a position on it. If they think it is a viable framework and they will be able to function within it, I expect you to say so. If you think it is not, I expect you to say so. I do not view this as a politically expedient motion. I take great offense at equating the ability of a school committee to put forth a responsible budget for educating children to the school committee taking a position on a wind turbine or anything that's completely unrelated to education. I was very disappointed that the council did not take a position on this FTR, because the council will also have to function within this framework that I think is severely flawed. That said, I encourage strongly the school committee to take a position on this so that I, as a voter and a taxpayer, can hold you accountable for it.
Thank you, Mr. Grant.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'll be as brief as I can. Mike Burke, I'm here as a parent of a child in the public schools, and as a taxpayer, and I don't pretend to speak for any other parent or any other taxpayer, and I take offense to anyone who suggests that they know what the majority of taxpayers, before a vote happens in this town, want. Nobody has that magic ball, that crystal ball. Nobody. And nobody has the right to pretend that they speak for people who have not given that permission to do so. It is your job. And I'm not going to talk about the pros and cons, because we've all debated this publicly, and it is a public discussion. And having debates in public about public policy is not dirty. It is democracy. It's what we're built on. So please entertain these discussions about issues that are critical to the education system in Tiverton. both of these issues before you tonight are critical to that. And you have every right and responsibility to consider whether or not to take a position. You may choose not to, but at least you've considered it. You may choose to support it, but at least you've considered it. I would disagree with you if you did, but that's okay. That's what democracy is about. It's about public discourse and doing so in a manner that allows and does not try to bully others by suggesting that your vote is a declaration of war against parents and taxpayers if you would vote to oppose this. That's bullying behavior. In fact, you have courses, you have programs against bullying in the schools. So please set that aside, that bullying behavior aside, because democracy is about public discourse and debate. And I hesitate to point out these last two things, but I feel a need to because it gets back into the bullying behavior. Well, before I get to that, let me just talk about, and Ms. Zepke talked about some of the other red herrings. You're not going to take votes on wind turbines. You're not going to take votes on who should be on the council and who shouldn't. And if you did, then you'd probably be thrown out of office the next time you ran for office. That's what democracy is about, too. But let me get back to the bullying behavior and just finish with this. Part of public discourse is being able to have conversations in print and in person that are safe conversations. Now, I hope these two comments that I heard Mr. Karen whisper in the back of the room were figurative and not literal. And I won't repeat them verbatim because of the language used in them. One comment, while Mr. Robinson was speaking, I'm going to beat the crap out of this guy. Now, substitute a different word for crap. And to Mr. Wierick, when he was responding to Mr. Burgundy's comments, an effing liar. So I leave it at that.
Madam Chair, may I? I'd just like to point out there were questions raised as to where we got our information when we suggested some of these things had not been addressed. Clearly, the ambiguity issue over the bifurcation was always on the table. We took our information from the information provided to us by Mr. Karen. He had a matrix, and you could see very clearly from it whether concerns of Ms. Herman or Ms. Polish or others had been addressed or not addressed. So it was his information, and we did have the latest iteration of the language.
Mrs. Black?
I'm sorry, I just have a statement that I would like to request the recusal of Mrs. Herman and Ms. Polish based on the appearance of Mr. Burke, and I have a statement that I'll hand into you for the minutes. This is basically the same logic that you brought to the town council back in June.
Okay, thank you. Yes, thank you. As far as the whether or not, I just want to address quickly, we should be taking a position on it, and certainly I appreciate everyone's comments, but I do want to remind the committee that in December of 2010, we passed unanimously a code of basic management principles and ethical school standards. They are available online. They are from Law 16209-1. Within it, it says, the school committee accepts the obligations to operate the public schools in accordance with the fundamental principles and standards of school management, which principles include, but are not limited to, the following: exercising legislative, policy-making, planning, and appraising functions, acting on legislation and policy making matters after examining pertinent facts and considering the superintendent's recommendation. If the financial, we are changing law. We are changing the law of Tiverton. We are changing law with respect to our educational budget. If that's not a legislative matter, I don't know what is. We take positions on the pension. We just did. And the impact it was going to have on our budget. We take positions on binding arbitration because it's going to impact our budget. We take positions on legislative matters. Not only should we take them, we're required to take them. So I would remind everyone that we're doing what we've all agreed to do when we pass this policy and in accordance with state law as the Board of Education. And that responsibility is given to all of us by the state. Just quickly, and I do appreciate all the comments on both sides of this. Certainly as a parent in the system for 11 years, having been in town for 26 years, I do wholeheartedly talk with my parents. I take into consideration what they say. They don't always agree with me, but I listen. I listen to them at games. I listen to them at meetings. I listen to them at functions. So to say that I'm not listening to them is a little bit of an affront. But in any event, I think that there are, I want to acknowledge the effort of the FTM CAC, of which I was an original member. I understand how difficult it is. I was an original member of the 2008 Charter Review. So I understand what they've gone through. I understand wanting to find an alternative to the FTM. I want to find it too. My problem is this simply is not it. It introduces more problems than it solves with respect to our education budget. And I think it introduces, and both Mr. Robinson and Mr. Rearick covered them well, unacceptable risks and jeopardizes school funding. And to not take a position on that is not doing the job I was elected to do. Consequently, just to move along, I'm going to make a motion that we accept Mr. Rearick's recommendation and that we oppose the referendum.
I'll second the motion, and may I speak? Sure. The reason we should take a position on the proposed financial town referendum is the same reason we just took a position on pension reform legislation, because it has a direct financial impact on our schools. The FTR could potentially have a disastrous impact on our school finances, just as a lack of pension reform could have a disastrous impact on our school finances. And I would just like to point out that no one in this room objected to our vote calling for pension reform legislation. I would also like to refer once again to state law, which states that our first and greatest concern as school committee members must be the educational welfare of our students. The FTR, by allowing school budgets below the minimum required by law to appear on the ballot, does not promote the educational welfare of our students. And that's why I believe we need to take a position opposing it.
Anyone else? No?
I think.
Okay,
Anne? I just want to make clear that no matter how we vote on this, no one can take away from us our obligation and the power to defend the students and defend the budgets and to provide the education to the students. This cannot be taken away from us by the laws or interpretation of the town charter provided in Tiverton, because we are still in the state of Rhode Island, I want to remind everyone. What this might do is make things more difficult, create more lawsuits, having to pursue cruel acts to actually fund the education. Obviously, it's going to be a nuisance, but in terms of the final result, if someone thinks that this can be used to underfund the schools, it cannot happen. It can just make it more difficult for us to manage our budgets and get what's appropriate.
I just want to say, I understand what you're saying, regarding that, but why would we want, I guess the concerns are the concerns, but why
My job's to advise the committee. My advice to the committee, it's more of a question. You're absolutely right. But why should the committee endorse or not, or support something that we know is going to make things worse, or we believe they're going to be worse than they are? We don't want lawsuits. Mr. Coulter talked about Corullo. We don't want to do that.
Yeah.
So why, to the committee, why would we support an instrument that could lead to more of that? We're trying to avoid that. We're trying to go down, not go down those paths, as Mrs. Black has pointed out. And you know, I think I got to say that, because that's what I'm trying to advise the council, the committee on. We're looking at something that just would, from our standpoint, I believe, make things worse.
Yeah.
From a funding standpoint. Okay. And why go there if we can avoid it, is my recommendation to the committee.
Okay, just one last thing I'd like to say. I think that we'd all agree that we vetted this. We have people four times for hours and back and forth in open session, even to the point where a lot of our things were disposed of. That's the word I heard of. The 1218 I kept asking about. In fact, it was on TV in the auditorium when I came up to the podium again to ask about 1218, which is this thing that says we can't use our labor, elected officials, and I have never felt so confined in my life. When I go out, I say, am I on a town street? Am I on a state property? I just don't want to violate that. But Mrs. Driggs, when I went up there, she was so upset. I can understand why she's asking this again. She shook her head and put her hands in her head, and then people were calling me up. They said, no, she has a right to do that, because I keep asking the same question, but there are more questions than answers. And our lawyer has advised us. I've been with him for 8 years. He's one of the best in the state. He's always given me good advice. So that's all in favor?
No, we have to read what we are voting on.
Oh, I made a motion to oppose the... to approve Bill's recommendation to oppose
the superintendent's recommendation.
Right? Thank you. The superintendent's recommendation to propose to oppose the financial town referendum on November 8th. Question number two.
And I had the second.
Yes, I was the second.
And it's time for the vote.
Just make sure the record reflects that I have requested recusal from two of your members, please. Thank
yes.
you.
All those in favor? All those against? Abstain.
I believe at this point we'd like to move
yes.
up item 6B, update on the Board of Regents decision.
Yes, because...
Could we take the motion?
Yes,
and, I make the motion to move that up. Is there a second?
Second. All those in favor?
So you're going to do... sorry.
I think that will flow.
6B and 6C.
Yeah, I think that will flow a little yeah. more naturally. Steve, would you like to brief the committee?
On Monday, the parties to the... appeal of the council's action of seizing school department money was heard by the commissioner, as we all know, and we were upheld before the commissioner, hearing officer, after quite a spirited hearing with testimony from accountants and others. That decision was appealed to the Board of Regents. The procedure the Board of Regents follows is to have a subcommittee with their attorney hear the appeals, the arguments of the lawyers. They then vote then and there to make a recommendation to the full Board of Regents, which will be coming up in a week or two, their meeting. After consideration of the arguments, the subcommittee voted unanimously to deny the appeal of the town of the commissioner's ruling. They also have suggested that the tuition monies will go into a general account, but there may be, and I may wish to come back to you with a recommendation on that, there are still some questions about that that I hope they're going to address in there. I raised the arguments before the regents, and I hope they address it, but if they do not, I may come back to you with further recommendations on that. I think it's important, and I'd just like to give a little bit of the history of how we got from there to here on this, because I think it's important in understanding. From here, by the way, if the town is not satisfied with the ruling by the Board of Regents, they are entitled to file a petition for certiorari to the Supreme Court. And that is a discretionary writ. It's not, they don't have a right of appeal. They'd have to try to convince the court that their opinion is correct and the court should consider it. If they do not do that, it becomes a final decision. And that final decision can be enforced by the Superior Court. So should the same midnight raid occur this year as happened last year, they could be subject to contempt of court or other aspects of legal process. And in terms of this, the frustrating part in this has been throughout, I think the committee has made our position very clear. The precedent and the statutes, in my opinion, are very clear. The commissioner has ruled on them many times. I respect Attorney Teitz. I think he's wrong, clearly wrong, on his opinion that he gave the council. But it is important to note that in the prior fiscal year, remember now, this is an action the council took, I believe it was 19 months after the financial town meeting of May of 2009. So, and by the way, the financial town meeting at that meeting did not bifurcate. They made a total appropriation in 2009. So bold and don't try to confuse me with the facts from the other side. Mr. Dansereau, who was the accountant, acknowledged at hearing that he couldn't explain why the audit report had come out as it had. Well, now, in February of 2010, the committee had heard rumblings that the council was intent on seizing this money, this $267,000, $367,000, and that they would rely on an argument that really the town only has to put in the money that is locally appropriated, that it's a bifurcated process. If the state says they're going to give you X, we give you Y, and if the state doesn't give you X, you don't get X and Y, you only get what we gave you. That essentially, in a nutshell, is their argument. And when advised to this, the committee, and I believe it was Chairman, I believe it was you, Ms. Black, advised them that this was improper, inappropriate, and not consistent with law. That was not responded to, but a memorandum in March from the town solicitor indicating he thought you could do that. The school committee then went to the Commissioner of Education, and the significance of that is, by law, the commissioner, other than the courts and the Board of Regents, the only person who can interpret education law is the Commissioner of Education. She has that power bestowed on her by law. The school committee asked the commissioner, anticipating a problem, does the town have the right to do this, and must they fund the total amount if the state doesn't give you the total amount? She said the town does not have the right to do it, and they must fund the total amount if the state comes up short. That was forwarded. And then there was the Eve of Christmas act by the council to take the money, notwithstanding being advised otherwise, 19 months after it was appropriated. That led us to seeking an appeal with the commissioner on what was settled law, in my opinion. It's settled law. A full hearing, great expense to both the town and to the school committee, to be told what we told you before was right. So where it stands now is, as I indicated before, the town now has to, this ruling, I know there are those who say it's just the commissioner's opinion, it has the force of law, and you disregard it at your own peril. So I'll answer any questions from the committee if there is any at this time.
How long do they have, is there a timeline for how long the council can appeal to?
It's not an appeal. It's called a petition for certiorari. It's a discretionary writ, and 30 days.
To review the ruling?
I believe so.
We believe it's 30 days.
Oh, okay.
But as far as we are concerned, it is now a final act, and so I believe would probably the next step was just be to write to the council and say, you know, here it is. We want affirmation in some fashion. Exactly. And if we don't get an answer to that, I'll come back and make further recommendations to you on next steps.
Okay. What were you saying regarding a general fund, something that was mentioned?
The tuition, there were two issues. The second issue was a tuition issue. And the tuition issue was, the statute says very clearly that tuition issues are to go for school purposes. And so there was a variety of correspondence here that never got responded to, by the way. Virtually none of our communications get responded to.
To who, Mr. Robinson?
To the council, regarding the disposition not only of the 367, but the tuition funds and other things. By the way, we did ask, we're very concerned that this money was just kind of by fiat going where the council determined they wanted it to go, whether they followed the law or not. So the tuition money that did come in, we asked the commissioner, we asked for an advisory opinion of the commissioner, because we believe there was some ambiguity in the decision that came out from the hearing officer as to that part. There was no ambiguity, in my opinion, as to the first part. That's bifurcating. But the other one, and that goes to an esoteric legal issue that I don't want to bore you with, but the question is, what's in the budget, what's not in the budget, what happens to the surplus and things of that nature. So there were some ambiguities as to that. But we asked an advisory of the commissioner. We've now gotten, you know, we're going to have this check come in for $118,000 for this. May we, you know, how do we dispose of this while we're in the middle of litigation? Unfortunately, the commissioner never responded to us. The parties brought it up before the regents on Monday, and the regents indicated they believed it should go into the general fund. I certainly did argue that it had to be isolated for school purposes, which the statute clearly says. And then there was a second issue of what about if you get more money in than you expect to get in? So that they had if you had a budget amount, let's say $50,000, and $100,000 comes in, all other surpluses the school department gets to keep. So what happens to that? And I don't think the commissioner really answered that part. But.
Yeah, they brought it up.
That's.
So the you can't bifurcate. I got that. And
right.
The Fall River tuition, it goes in the general fund, but you have to spend it on education.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a. If you were weighing the two issues, one would be 90%, the other would be 10%. The tuition thing is really small potatoes. Okay.
Can I address the Fall River tuition issue? This matter, you know, I've seen it on tape at one meeting, and I've had reports of a second. This issue has been talked about twice at the town council meetings, the last two. These discussions were, I would describe as heated, with one town council member stating that they thought that the Fall River tuitions, the way they were handled, was a form of embezzlement. Needless to say, when I first was told, well, a council member said that regarding myself and Mr. Fiore, I said, no one would say that. Well, I saw it on tape, and a committee member, council member, excuse me, said that. Needless to say, I was speechless when I saw it, and upset and insulted by it. The comment was unfounded, unnecessary, and baseless. This vicious rhetoric that is being put forward against the school committee has to stop, because it's tearing the town apart. And quite frankly, had someone, you know, I heard a lot about talk today about people who came to address the committee about communication and collaboration. Well, if someone had a concern regarding the tuition funds, all they had to do was pick up the phone and call Doug or myself. And we would have told them how much the money was for, when it was deposited. It was deposited, I have the bank statement right here, and it was deposited in a town account, because we can't have our own private accounts.
And when was that, the deposit?
August 4th.
So it has been in a town account since.
Absolutely, I have it right here. And had someone bothered to pick up the phone to inquire, by the way, and you know, where's the money? You've had it, and you still have it.
Excuse me?
I'm talking
may
to the council.
May I interject here?
No.
He's out of order.
He's out of order.
Will you?
Thank
you.
So therefore, I take great issue. And if someone wants to question what was said, I'll be happy to show that meeting where a council member accused me or alluded that Mr. Fiore and I might be embezzling money. It's got to stop. Thank you, Madam Chair.
I just want to respond briefly from the perspective of a member of the town council. I repeatedly, and I think Mrs. Black, you would agree with me, I repeatedly asked at town council meetings, where is the Fall River money? When is the Fall River money coming in? What are we going to do with the Fall River money? I never got a response to that, and I simply assumed we did not get the money. Two weeks ago, Mrs. Surrett, our treasurer, took the initiative to contact your business manager. She was advised at that time that you, in fact, had received the money sometime before June 14th of this year. I haven't made any accusations, Mr. Rearick.
No, you
I
didn't.
Haven't done any name calling.
No, one of your
but,
members
but
did.
But on the issue of communication, and I'm being quite sincere about this, there was an issue, there is an issue that was before the Board of Education. I think that you at least could have communicated at some point, we received the $118,000.
We did. We told the treasurer when the money came in. And it's in your account. It's right here. The fact that the treasurer didn't know that. We don't normally communicate our deposits to the town council. That's not our purview. Our purview is working with the treasurer. The fact that you folks didn't know you had the money, someone should have bothered to pick up the phone and ask us. You said you had inquiries. Have you ever spoken to me on the phone or sent me an email
asking that inquiry?
But have you asked that, sir?
But I do know what the normal...
No, you haven't.
No, I haven't.
Okay.
But I will tell you what the normal procedure has been, because I've seen the correspondence when this issue came up with Phil DiMatteo. And the procedure was that either for the business manager or a secretary to send the check with a letter to the town to the treasurer's office.
That did not occur.
That was done year after year after year.
Can I explain what
you knew that there was an issue of $118,000.
And we put it into an account, a town account, on the advice of our attorney. We put it into one of the accounts. We did what our attorney advised us, because in previous years, no town council had ever taken money from us before, and that this issue was unresolved at the time. We sent numerous correspondence to your attorney and to your council, and we have the documents. You folks did not respond to this committee or to our attorney.
The fact is you never responded to us, sir. $118,000. You knew it was an issue. You knew I was asking the question repeatedly. And you didn't have the good sense to call up the town council or send me a letter and say, Oh, by the way, Mr. Lambert, we did receive this money 4 months ago. What you did was hide it in an account, and now you're trying to blame the treasurer. The fact is, the only blame is with you, Mr. Rarick.
Thank you, Mr. Lambert.
Thank you.
I wanted to just address some of these comments. I think that we all get heated. We all are passionate about what we do. The town council is very passionate about what they do. We're very passionate about what we do. We all take it very seriously. I think these bombastic comments, though, are becoming a distraction from the jobs that we do. I think our residents deserve better. I think I've been trying to ignore them, but since I've been on the committee less than a year, I've been accused of purposely making our information misleading and hard to understand. I've been accused of putting forth an illegal budget. I've been, the school committee, the language that was used was abusing children. Now I'm being accused of a felon. You know, we're embezzled. Mr. Coulter talks of trying to bridge a gap, but then on the very next, he turns his head and then he makes all those statements. You cannot bridge a gap if you continue to have that level of unacceptable civil discourse. You just can't. When we found out that this money was taken, moved by the treasurer, we didn't throw a tantrum. We didn't accuse anybody of embezzling money. We didn't, like, you know, we calmly said, okay, what do we do? How do we get information? How do we work through our attorney? I absolutely agree, you know, Mr. Lambert, that we need to try to work together, but when those kind of comments are coming continuously from members of the council, it makes it very, very difficult, and it needs to stop. It's a distraction. It's a distraction none of us need. When you hear an appointed official declare that this is a declaration of war, it doesn't help. There's no place for it. And we really do need to move on. What else do you, I don't know if anyone else has.
I would like to speak a little bit to this issue. I would just like to remind town council members that if you ever have questions about our budget or about any school committee business or school department handlings, the town council meeting is not the time and place to raise those questions and get answers, simply because the school committee and our superintendent and our finance director are not present to answer them. So I realize you got frustrated perhaps raising at town council meetings questions about our budgets, but we would have no way of knowing that unless we were watching or attending through the late hours. You are always welcome to pick up a phone and call our central administration building. You are always welcome to put in a request for an agenda item to come and talk to us or to look at our agenda. And when you see that we have a topic that you have questions on, please join us. We will always let you speak. We will always answer your questions to the best of our ability. I would also just like to make a comment about the level of rhetoric which we unfortunately keep hearing. It seems that all too often the school department and the school committee are accused and convicted of wrongdoing in the same breath at a town council meeting, and then only later sometimes is there any request to find out if there is in fact evidence to support the accusation or conviction. We do need to stop throwing around inflammatory words like embezzlement. It does not ease tension or bring people together. So that would be my request. Please, when you have questions, do not immediately accuse and convict us of wrongdoing, but come to us with your questions and we will provide all the information that we have available.
I'd like to hope that someday this community is not going to be divided like it is today. But I'll tell you that it is. And there's a chasm between both sides. It's very easy for me to say, look at all those bad people that attacked me and said terrible things. And on the other side, I'm a liar. It goes on every day. The truth of the matter is that this is a very contentious relationship right now between the council and between the school committee. And I would think that relationship is defined in some ways by the superintendent, who feels that it's his own best interest to approach this relationship in the most aggressive manner possible. So I'm going to repeat that at some point we're going to come together. It's not anytime soon. Not when I see a public exchange between a superintendent and a town council member that looks like that. That's disgraceful. Thank you very much.
Mr. Nelson, last night at the town council meeting, when I was sitting there, it's like 12:45, and I was sitting there by myself, and you said three times last night that us not telling him about the money was an act of defiance. You said it's an act of defiance. You said it's an open act of defiance, and I see a pattern of behavior.
Agreed. That's exactly right.
While I'm sitting there alone, that's what you said.
I said that.
You said it
three times. I said that when there were a full audience as well,
right.
And I'll stand by those remarks.
But I'm just saying, so that's not something that would foster, being called there. It was 10:01 in the morning when I heard the word embezzlement. I almost fell off on the floor, I'm saying.
Well, you know what? If we took a step back and asked ourselves, why did that occur? We could find event after event that led to event that led to event that led to that night. In my own personal opinion, discarding decades or years of a process that says you get a check, you send us a letter, the treasurer gets it, puts it in, that's notification. The treasurer honestly didn't know. The treasurer doesn't have any communications that said we got this check. The treasurer doesn't know how much the check was for and didn't know when it was received or what account it went in. None of those things occurred. And in the absence of that, whether or not there's a legal requirement to do it, in the absence of that, we're left wondering. So when a remark about embezzlement takes place, it's in the absence of communication.
So why didn't you find the facts first before that was allowed to be said?
One might say...
No, why wasn't... No, why didn't
that,
anyone...
Can you let me answer the question or not?
No, we're not going to... No.
Let's move on.
Look,
so if you're going to ask me a question, I'll answer it, but don't interrupt me.
No.
So my point is that there will be event after event that will take place until the leadership of this town decides to get together and really do something together. A really good example of that is the FTR tonight. That divide is here to stay until our leadership can decide otherwise.
Thank you, Mr. Nelson. The one last thing I'll say is when the word embezzlement came up and they said we should start an investigation in the morning with the Attorney General, and you asked the question, how can we start that? And I would say we could start that by making a phone call to Mr. Field. That's all, and that would have ended that story right there.
It would have ended it. A letter ahead of time would have prevented it.
And the other thing is...
Do you agree with that?
Yes, but every year
we send
the money. Every year we send the money, as you said. The check is made out to the school department.
Agreed.
Because it's for the children.
Yes.
We sign it over to the town. If someone took $367,000 from you, would you in the next week send them? Here, take this $118,000 again. That's why we had the questions of what we should do with it. That's all.
Well, let's be clear.
We don't care where.
I heard a remark that said the town council took money away from you. Well, everybody knows that that's clearly not the case. That was the treasurer of the town, who's an independent entity that we did not appoint. Selected by the people.
No, you guys.
I just say something.
It's the dead guy.
If we're going to move on, thank you all very much.
I just hope that the taxpayers of Tiverton are watching this. I hope they are watching it and they are going to make the right decisions in all the elections. This town cannot be run like this. This is like bickering between children. This is this is completely not acceptable, and nothing is going to change. It's like a couple which is in the middle of the divorce. What we should have, like they have one of these thermometers when they are going to do some fundraisers, they should just give this for legal fees so everyone driving by the town hall everywhere else can see whether we are already at $300,000 or $400,000 or $500,000. And this could be a good indicator. We can have two, blue and red, one for town council, one for school committee, and they will see how their money is spent. On simple bickering, calling names, that's, you know, I completely gave up on this. So I just had to say something because us observing this as for many, many years, I don't know. At the end, no one is going to win. So, but I lost hope that you are talking about getting together and finding some common ground. This is never going to happen. The best thing that happened recently are all these lawsuits. Because like in a divorce, the judge at the end is going to decide what's going to be, and at some point you will say, look at that, you cannot do this again. You cannot take this money from which was allocated for education, because here is the judgment. We had financial town meetings where we were waiving the decision of the commissioner. And you were thinking that these were scare tactics. No, these were not scare tactics. This was a tip of the iceberg, which now we can see a little bit more of it. And that's what's going to happen. At the end, someone else has to tell us what is the color of the money and what has to happen, because obviously we will never agree. I agree with you on one thing, that this town is split beyond the cure. Someone else will make these decisions for us, voters and judges.
Okay, number seven, request.
Yes, you have a, it's really more of a correspondence. It's the follow-up to a correspondence that we received from a resident regarding a claim that one of our custodians, while mowing the lawn, damaged the front headlight of the resident's car. We received the complaint from the resident. We also received a police complaint. We forwarded it to the trust. They investigated it, and you have the letter and their findings, which said that there was nothing to support the claim.
Okay. Okay.
Is
that it?
Reports and announcements.
We have executive session.
Reports and announcements. School high school has its college fair this Thursday. Starts at
5:30.
And if you, it's too late now, but the haunted house is still going on.
Do we still get the
Although, maybe it was here. Maybe people should have come here instead. I'm not sure.
Why didn't we sell tickets here?
Could I just ask the committee to consider, and I'm sorry because it seems it's created quite the conversations when I ask these questions. Would it be feasible to have the NEA negotiations that we have a separate night just to go over and review it so that
yes.
we can be fresh? Because
yes,
I don't think.
Absolutely.
Nothing good happens after
Well, I was going to use that. I just don't think.
Has
we're,
your wife needle pointed that for you yet?
Is it possible? Would the committee be.
After 10.
At a meeting, not at home. At a meeting.
Yeah, right.
Tuesday? Would the committee be willing to meet next Tuesday just to deal with this?
What's the date?
It's the first?
Yeah, I have a 4 o'clock meeting.
How about if we send some dates out?
But in the evening.
Yeah.
If that's okay. Okay, I'll send some.
I think I can.
Send some
Thanks.
Dates out. Okay.
Okay. So are we then looking for a motion to adjourn?
Yes.
I will make the motion to adjourn.
Second.
Carol.